In the previous video, we introduced the idea of proteases being important in the signaling in biology. In this video, I want to go ahead and look at two different catalytic mechanisms for these proteases. Okay, so both of these enzymes catalyze hydrolysis reactions, and you'll recall that hydrolysis is using water to break a covalent bond. And in this case, the covalent bond that we're breaking is the amide linkage, or the peptide backbone, in a protein. So what I'm showing here is water in red and the peptide bond in green. And we'll use this color scheme throughout this entire video. And recall, in this process, what we end up with is the water coming in and reacting with this bond, replacing that bond with pieces of the water. And we end up with the peptide backbone being severed, where we have our original carbonyl here from the peptide backbone being replaced with an alcohol group from water, and we end up with the other part of the water molecule being replaced, being placed onto the nitrogen. So we end up with an amine, and we end up with a carboxylic acid. And this is the reaction that both of these enzymes we're going to talk about catalyze. But the really big thing that I want to stress, the reason that these enzymes are important, is that they make this process go much faster. So as it turns out, water itself is not a very good nucleophile under the conditions that enzymes catalyze. And remember that we require a nucleophile to initiate the attack, or to initiate this chemical reaction where it reacts with that carbonyl. So if water is not a good enough nucleophile to make this process happen quickly, then the role of the enzyme is to make water into a better nucleophile so that the reaction can go faster. So with that in mind, let's go ahead and explore the first of our two enzymes. We'll look at the easier one first, which relies only on two aspartic acids present in the active site of the enzyme to play a role in the catalysis. Okay, so what I'm showing here is the active site of the enzyme represented in white. And what we see is we see two different aspartic acids, both in fairly close proximity to each other, and both of which can interact with a water molecule that I've drawn in red. The other thing that we see is in green, a peptide backbone. Okay, so you should recognize the amide linkage that creates a peptide bond in a backbone. So I'm showing a single peptide bond in green. And I'm going to show all electron flow in yellow so that it's easier for you to follow along. Okay, so in the first step in this reaction, what we need to do is convert water into a better nucleophile. And the way the enzyme can do this is by deprotonating the water and creating a hydroxide anion. The enzyme can use this lone pair on the aspartic acid in the active site to reach out, pull off the proton from water, forming hydroxide. Once we've made hydroxide, we now have a really good nucleophile that can initiate the reaction by attacking the electrophilic carbon in the peptide backbone. And we've seen before that when you attack an electrophile, we've created a new covalent bond, so we need to break a covalent bond. And in this case, the electrons are drawn up onto the oxygen to break the double bond, making an oxyanion. The modest rearrangement of atoms around that originally electrophilic carbon from a trigonal planar into a tetrahedral geometry now puts this hydrogen in perfect location for the nitrogen in the backbone to deprotonate it. And we know this deprotonation step is really important because it now puts the positive charge on the nitrogen, which when our carbonyl reforms or our tetrahedral intermediate collapses, the electrons that go to this carbon are now attracted to the nitrogen, so it's the peptide bond we sever, not that CO bond that we just made. And when this step completes, we have actually now severed the peptide backbone, right? The hydrolysis reaction is technically complete. But the problem is that we observe an OH, a protonated carboxylic acid, still present in the active site. And if you remember, at the beginning of this mechanism, the very first step relied on a deprotonated aspartic acid to be able to react with water to convert water into a good nucleophile. So for this mechanism to be completely done and completely done correctly, we have to regenerate our active site, okay? Which means deprotonating our aspartic acid. And we're gonna do this either using the lone pair on our carboxylate or the lone pair on the amine. And the one that we're gonna choose is the one that under biological pHs should be protonated. We know that carboxylic acids stay deprotonated, but typically under biological conditions, we know that amines are usually protonated. So we can just deprotonate our carboxylic acid using our amine. So we have now regenerated our active site and we've completed our reaction so the products can diffuse out of the active site and we can have a new water molecule and a new peptide backbone come into the active site so the reaction can start over. So this is the mechanism by which pepsin works. It's a hydrolase that relies on these two aspartic acids in the active site of the enzyme to catalyze the hydrolysis reaction. The other enzymes we talked about, enterokinase, trypsin, and chymotrypsin all rely on a mechanism catalyzed by a catalytic triad, okay? These all fall into the category of what are known as serine proteases. And in the next video, we'll explore how serine proteases work.